Thank you very much, and good afternoon, everyone. As already said, I'm here in my capacity as a Justice Committee member during this short mandate we've had. But I'd like to welcome everybody for coming along today, and it's good to see you. So yes, the theme for today's case is the Northern Ireland Prison Reform Programme, progress made and challenges remaining. And our speaker, Dr. Michelle Butler of the Queen's University in Belfast, is going to share her research findings on some of the challenges facing government, both the Executive and the Assembly, in the context of prisons in Northern Ireland. Since the devolution of justice powers in Northern Ireland, initiated through the Hillsborough Agreement in 2010, a major review of Northern Ireland prison conditions, management and oversight has been taken. In 2011, findings from the review fed into a significant penal reform programme. And today, Dr. Butler will reflect on some aspects of this reform so far. She will outline key and current achievements before moving on to discuss some of the main challenges. In particular, her research focuses on the use of data in terms of understanding assaults in prisons in Northern Ireland, including both prisoner-on-prisoner assaults and prisoner-staff assaults. I know the Justice Committee will be interested in receiving the content of this presentation, as will many others. And indeed, when the Justice Minister speaks on the floor, it's always a very hot topic of debate, so there is wide interest in this issue. And I intend to have today's presentation also distributed to the Justice Committee members. I note from the seminar's attendee list that here today there's a number of officials from the Executive and the Assembly and MLA staff, officials from the third sector and academia and elsewhere. So I'm pleased to see that you're all here, and I hope that you will participate in the Q&A afterwards. It's a knowledge exchange seminar, so please do engage and do stay for refreshments afterwards and see if we can widen out the conversation. Thank you very much. Dr. Butler, over to you. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Michelle, and thank you all for coming today. I know there's a lot going on, so I really appreciate you taking the time to come and listen to me talk. And hopefully you'll feel like it was worth your while at the end of the talk. One thing I will say just to start off with is the time that I have to do this presentation in is not very long. So I would really refer you to the content of the briefing paper to have a more in-depth look at some of the topics that I'm referring to. So really all I'm doing in this presentation is just briefly highlighting some of those issues. We can talk more about them in the questions at the end, or you can always contact me as a follow-up after this event as well. My contact details are in the briefing paper and in this presentation. 20 minutes is also nowhere near enough time to cover all the wide range of issues that are linked to any prison reform programme. So I'm only going to be able to pick out a few, and you may have questions at the end about issues that I haven't covered that I will do my best to try and respond to. So as Claire has already said, as part of the Hillsborough Agreement and the devolution of justice powers to the Northern Ireland Assembly, it was agreed that there would be an independent review into prison conditions, management and oversight. That independent review published two reports. The first one, an interim report, and the focus of that interim report was really identifying some of the main stumbling blocks that they saw being in the way of driving forward a reform programme and resulting in a more up-to-date prison service in Northern Ireland. That interim report fed into the then programme, the C programme, the Strategic Efficiency and Effectiveness programme. Now, I realise people might not talk much about the C programme anymore, but that was the official programme that was launched in 2011, a few months after the interim report. And it was envisaged as a four-year change programme which hoped to see the prison service be more compact, cost-effective, with a more enhanced focus on rehabilitation, desistance and reduced offending at the end of it. Obviously, 4 years is a shorter time frame than the reform programme for the police, and the budget for the reform of the prison service was obviously more restricted than during the police as well. A few months after the launch of the C programme, the independent review team launched their final report, or published their final report. And in this report, they expressed disappointment at the lack of progress that had been made in overcoming some of the obstacles they had identified in their interim report. But they nonetheless went ahead and they said they didn't want to miss the opportunity of outlining various recommendations that they saw as being kind of key to helping Northern Ireland get a prison service that was more appropriate for our society at that time. There's been a lot of focus on the achievement of these 40 recommendations as a barometer to judge the success of the reform programme. And probably I would just say I think it's important that we reflect on the interim report as well and the issues in that, because none of us can get where we want to be if we don't overcome obstacles on the way as well. So, where are we now? So, some of the achievements to date have included a greater focus on rehabilitation, desistance, and resettlement across all the four prison institutions. There was rehabilitation, resettlement, desistance work ongoing within the prisons before the launch of the C programme, and that what the reform programme did was try and enhance and develop that work and put that work more at the centre of our prison system. The Criminal Justice Inspectorate in its reports, in the most up-to-date reports, have seen an increase and in this area across all the four prison estates since before the launch of the reform programme. We've also seen increased cooperation and engagement with outside agencies with a view to supporting change. So there was outside agencies already involved in working with the prison service before the reform programme. That has been built on, enhanced, and we've now seen the transfer of responsibility for delivery of key prison services to outside agencies as part of that. We have seen reduced numbers of people coming into the prison service on remand, find fault, young males and females. So what we're seeing there is increasing diversion from the use of imprisonment where alternatives to imprisonment are deemed to be appropriate. And that was one of the key recommendations of the prison review team. That has also been useful because up until more recently, what we had been seeing was an increase in the average daily number of people imprisoned, which when we had more people going into the prison system and we had costs going down, was putting more pressure on the prison system. So actually reducing the number of people going into the prison has helped relieve some of that pressure as well in more recent times. In addition to being more useful for hopefully diverting those individuals from a career and further reoffending as well. We have seen the cost per prisoner place reduce significantly. So from 2009 to 2010, we've seen the cost per prisoner place decrease by 27%. Efforts to reduce the cost of imprisonment were not solely linked to this reform programme. They were ongoing prior to the launch of the C programme. They've been ongoing for quite a while. They were given a greater impetus by the global financial crisis in 2007, 2008. So the prison service had already been reducing its staffing numbers and costs in 2008, 2009 before that, as well as efforts ongoing before that as well. Obviously, some of these issues around improved cost effectiveness bring challenges with that as well, which the prison service is continuing to deal with and the other organisations involved in delivering services in there. Another thing that we've seen is prison state improvements and proposed new bills to help reconfigure the prison state with a view to improving the conditions for both those who are detained in prison and those who work in there. By updating some of the buildings in the prison estate, the design of the buildings, how we use those buildings where they're placed, it's hoped that we can improve safety, security and well-being for both those detained and imprisoned, that as well as make a better use of our resources. Subject to funding. So that brings us on to some of the challenges remaining with the reform programme. Needless to say, there's the ongoing financial difficulties that we face due to the wider fiscal climate within Northern Ireland. That was an issue prior to Brexit and prior to more recent events. This is going to become even more important now. We don't know the financial consequences of Brexit. They could be beneficial. It may reduce the money coming in. We just don't know. We don't know what the financial implications are with regards to the elections and the re-establishment of a Northern Ireland Assembly going forward, and what the financial consequences of those decisions might be. So prior to these events, I think the public sector, some in the audience will know much better than I, were required to make a 4.1% real terms reduction in their budgets, which was going to have a significant impact on all individuals involved in providing services in the prison service. And indeed, in previous documents submitted to the Department of Justice, the prison service itself had identified this as a risk going forward and how it was going to impact on its ability to deliver a regime which was going to maximise unlock, which was going to be able to provide sufficient services and supports for those in there, as well as the impact that that would have for those involved in the community and voluntary sector who were commissioned to provide services in there. So there's a wider impact of those events. We continue to have the issue around the managing of the separated prisoners and the consequences that has for the delivery of a regime to others within the prison, as well as those working in the prison and the families involved, and the wider political societal consequences of that. There continues to be issues around mental health and personality disorders. We've seen this quite vividly in recent prisoner ombudsman reports, where there's been concerns about whether prison is even a suitable environment for these individuals in the first place. Of course, if individuals are not being sent to prison, it means there needs to be alternative institutions for those individuals, for the courts to be able to divert those individuals into those institutions. This is not a new problem to Northern Ireland. Issues around the management of those with mental illness and psychiatric disorders is a long-standing one since the partition of the state. So it's unfortunately one that we have yet to get to grips with. And in particular, there's issues around the management of individuals who are deemed to be high risk. You know, we need to have facilities then that are secure facilities that can deal with not just moderate risk individuals, but those deemed to be high risk as well. There's the issue of strengthening relationships between staff and management, as well as enhancing leadership. That's not just a comment for the prison service. That's a comment for, I think, a number of agencies that are involved in providing services within the prison system. One of the things that we've seen is, as we said already, we've said the increasing role of outside agencies involved in providing services within the prison environment. With that comes more issues around contracts, service level agreements, clarity over what is being provided, what's not being provided, and then there needs to be very clear communication and management and oversight of those issues. And I think the Independent Monitoring Board's reports, inspection reports, management board minutes of the prison service, all of these reports have highlighted concerns at some stage about a range of different agencies involved in this. So I think that point, like I said, is for a number of organisations to think through. And that's understandable as well when we're moving into a new system where we have an increasing range of providers involved, as each get used to working in maybe an environment that is different to what they're used to, and build up relationships and understandings with each other, and as those issues are worked through. Linked to that point, ensuring that the Northern Ireland Prison Service and outside agencies work effectively together and recognise how all contribute to the culture, environment and prison reform programme. The activity of one agency can't be separated from another. They all feed into that overall culture within the prison service, the outcomes that we see for those imprisoned and for staff, and the environment. And changes to one can have a knock-on effect on the other. So it's important that those organisations are working together to try and best address all of those issues. Obviously, I'm an academic. Of course, I'm going to say greater use of data. But I do think that greater use of data to judge performance can help with some of these challenges as well. If I don't know what's going to be happening in the future, but given discussions about moving towards an outcomes-based model of accountability, then measuring performance is a key part of that. So we have to be very careful about what we measure and how we measure it to make sure that we're measuring the right things that give us a best view of what's happening on the ground as possible. When I was preparing this presentation, I saw a number of articles in the media which were using data, which was good that there was data in the media articles, which were using data to discuss different issues. And a lot of the time, I think, in those articles, there's been the use of raw data. So in other words, just the total amount of something happening. So with prison assaults, for example, saying how many assaults occurred in any one year in comparison to the previous year. But that doesn't necessarily take account of changes in the number of people imprisoned. If the number of people increase in a prison, you would expect to see an increase in the number of assaults occurring just purely by the fact that there is more people in the prison. Likewise, if the number went down, you would expect to see that number drop if you're just looking at the raw figures. So I think that what we need to do is try and move beyond those raw figures to actually looking at data that is adjusted to take account of population fluctuations. That then is going to allow us to look at our own performance over time so that we can see over time changes in that performance, which allows us to better assess whether something's improving or not. It also allows us to draw comparisons, international comparisons, to see, well, how are we performing here in comparison to other jurisdictions? So I decided that I would put a spotlight on some of the issues then that I saw in the media at that time in this presentation, just to demonstrate how data could be used in that way to help judge performance. So one of the stories that just happened to be in the media, you can tell I was doing the presentation around Christmas, was about prison and prisoner assaults. And there was a lot of talk about the number of assaults in prisons and what were the possible reasons for this. And one thing in particular that kind of stood out was talking about staffing levels. Okay, so I thought I would have a look at this issue. Without a shadow of a doubt, staffing levels are linked to safety and security in the prison. There is a link. But what hopefully I'm going to try and show you is it's more complicated than just looking at that one issue. Okay. So there's some points I want to make before I show you this, some caveats to the data. So this data is based on official reports, official records. There is some problems with using official records for prisoner-on-prisoner violence. And that is a lot of the times the cultural norms in the prison is that those imprisoned don't report bullying or violence to staff. Now, they will in some cases, but on the norm, they don't like to do that because there's social norms against snitching. The extent then to which staff are aware of those incidents depends on staffing levels. It will be part of that, but also how you're using your staff. Where are your staff? Are your staff in the locations in which they're going to see those fights or assaults occurring or become aware of those assaults? So you're talking about surveillance levels as well. Another caveat to these figures is recording practices. So what's being recorded? How is it being recorded? Is there a use of discretion there in what staff are actually doing on the landing and how they're recording incidences? So there's a number of caveats. Those caveats, however, apply to all official records on prisoner-prisoner assaults. So when I compare Northern Ireland's performance to England, Wales and Scotland, as you see in a minute, those caveats equally apply to the official records of England and Wales and Scotland. So what I'm doing is I've adjusted the total, the raw figures for the population trend. And the most common method of doing this is using a rate per 1,000 people imprisoned, okay? So what that means is for every 1,000 people imprisoned, the number that you'll see is the amount of assaults that are recorded. So for example, if there's a figure of 65, a rate of 65 given for Northern Ireland, that means for every 1,000 people imprisoned, there's 65 assaults, okay? So like I said, it takes account of changes in population. So when we look at Northern Ireland is red here. You can see, and I'm using kind of 2009, 2010 as kind of like a baseline, because that was before the start of the penal reform program, up until most recently, I know you can't really see it there in slides, 2015, 2016, okay? So we're looking at a 7-year time frame here. So what you can see there is that, yes, even when you take account of the number of people in prison, okay, we see that the prisoner-prisoner assault rates has increased over the years. Okay, we can see in particular there was an increase from the years 2009, 2010 to 2011, 2012. Now, I may as well talk about staffing levels now, why not? So with regards to the argument about staffing levels, the idea is that if there's a simple direct relationship between the number of uniformed staff employed by the prison and assaults, we would expect to see that the prisoner-prisoner assault rate would go up as the number of uniformed staff go down. And I'm focusing on uniformed staff because they're the ones who are on the landings. That's not exactly what we see here when you actually compare the figures. So if we use the number of uniformed staff in 2009-2010 as kind of like a baseline, between 2009-2010 and 2011-2012, when we see this, when the rate of prisoner-prisoner assault almost doubles, or does double, the difference in the number of uniformed staff employed is 6%. So there's a 6% drop there between the number employed 2009-2010 and 2011-2012. Now, if we look at the rest of the time, we can see some fluctuation, but it's reasonably stable rate for the rest of the time. What we see in 2012-2013 was an 18% reduction in staffing levels from the 2009-2010 levels. So that reduction in staff numbers is not mirrored by an increase in the prisoner-prisoner assault rates. If we look at 2015-2016, there was a 20% reduction in uniform staffing levels if you compare it to the 2009-2010 levels. And again, we don't see what we would expect to see if it was as simple as staffing numbers and a prisoner-prisoner assault rates. As I said, I'm going to reiterate again, staffing levels are important for safety and security. They do influence that. It's just there's other factors going on as well. And that includes the nature of the regime in operation, the individual characteristics and issues that those who are in the prison may be coming in with. So if you're diverting more people from prison earlier on, you might be ending up then with those who have more mental health issues, more serious substance misuse issues, anger management issues. You need to look at the number of services and supports that are there in the prison that can help deal with those issues, to help reduce violence in the prison then as well, not only when they get out and released. You're talking about issues from the person's outside home environment or community that might be affecting them and leading to flare-ups in the prison. There's a whole range of issues that can affect it. So it's a much more complicated picture. And like I said, we can talk a little bit more about that maybe in the questions and answers. So that's just looking at Northern Ireland. Let's look at England and Wales now and see how does our prisoner-prisoner assault rate compare to England and Wales. Well, what we can see is in comparison to 2009, 2010, we were much lower on our prisoner-prisoner assault rate, much lower. Nowadays, what we can see is that we kind of went up to match England and Wales. England and Wales have now started breaking ahead, and that reflects the issues that we see happening in English and Welsh prisons, and I wouldn't be surprised if that will go up even higher again. If we look at Scotland, how do we compare to Scotland? Well, we're significantly less on our prisoner-prisoner assault rate in Scotland. Looking then, doing the same thing, I'm going to use the rate per 1,000, like I said, to take account of population changes. Then looking at the prisoner staff assaults, well, what happened with that? If we look at Northern Ireland, what we can see is that it was staying steady between 2009, 2010, 2011, 2012, dropped in 2012, 2013, and then shot up from then onwards. Okay. Now again, if we look at staffing levels, if you remember, I said that in 2012, 2013, there was an 18% reduction in uniform staffing levels that year. Yet we see the rate of prisoner staff assault going down for that time. So what's happening there? I wouldn't know for sure without looking at the data, but one possible suggestion is increase in lockdowns. If people are locked, then the opportunities that they have to assault staff are lessened. Now, the longer that people are locked up, the more frustrated and angry they get, the more they may turn to substance misuse as a way of coping locked in the cells, and then you might see over time then assault rates going up as well. If we look at, so like I said, in 2012, 2013, it was an 18% reduction in uniform staffing numbers. The next year, 2012, 2014, you see where there was a massive increase in there on the prison staff assaults. Actually, at that time, the prison service hired an additional 191 uniformed officers, which meant that the staffing levels was only 7% less than 2009, 2010. So we can see that it's not quite as clear cut. Now, obviously, as new staff come in, they don't have the same, what we call in academic world of jail craft, as those who are more experienced. It takes time for those new staff to perfect their skills of learning to spot potential confrontational situations, and then of like using verbal skills or whatever techniques they have of trying to like de-escalate situations. If you want to know, in 2014, 2015, it was a 12% reduction in staffing levels, in uniform staffing levels in comparison to 2009, 2010. And in 2015, 2016, it was a 20% reduction. So again, how does this compare to other jurisdictions? Well, looking at England and Wales, we could see that we were around about similar rates in England and Wales up until 2013, 2014. England and Wales have also increased in their prison staff assault rates, and again are increasing significantly as of last year and may have even overtaken us in more recent figures. I have to wait for the financial year figures to come out to do a similar comparison. If we look at Scotland, we can see that the rate of prison staff assaults is lower in Scotland than either of the two other jurisdictions. Again, another thing that was in the media when I was preparing this presentation was deaths in custody. Again, I did this looking at the rate, so that would take account of changes in the population. What you can see there in comparison, so those figures refer to per 1,000 people imprisoned. And this looks at the total figures of deaths in custody. So that would include those naturally occurring deaths as well as self-inflicted deaths or other types of deaths occurring, all deaths within the prison. You'll notice that here in Northern Ireland, we fluctuate a lot more than the other jurisdictions. I don't know the reason for that. Again, I would have to look at the data in more detail to see it. When I was looking at the raw figures, they varied from 1 in a year to 8 in a year. You can see the massive peaks, like we can see that we have peaks and lows in that rate, but actually, if especially in comparison to the other jurisdictions where it seems to be a bit more of a stable figure, but if you look at the average over that 7-year time frame, that you can see that Northern Ireland is very similar to the other jurisdictions, if not a little bit lower than the other jurisdictions, but for whatever reason we fluctuate a lot more than the other jurisdictions, and it's definitely worthwhile investigating why. Looking then at international experiences of doing penal reform programs, what we see is what's referred to as this paradox of reform. So we can see that actually sometimes when you initiate reforms in a prison system, you can see periods of instability, friction, tension, and violence. So we can see an increase in disruption and a decrease in performance until people adjust to the new routines and new processes in place that have come in as a result of those reforms. And the length of time that takes depends on how fast that predictability is found and productive working relationships with other agencies is established. We also see that penal reforms may falter if the following are not recognised and addressed, and that is the costs of reforms, the limitations of penal institutions. What that means is, what is the size of the prison state? How many prison buildings do we have? What are the conditions of those prison buildings? What are the design in those? All of those things will impact on our ability to be able to take practices from other jurisdictions and then operate them in our jurisdiction. Because if you have practices that are working in a bigger prison estate and depend on the ability to be able to dilute the influence of disruptive individuals by spreading them across a wide range of prisons, we can't do that in Northern Ireland. We have only one high security prison. So all those that are most disruptive, no matter what we do, are going to be in that prison. So also, the design of our prison buildings, some of our buildings, can limit what we could do as well, or changes to staffing levels. So it's important that you take account of the limitations of the existing penal institutions. There's also the issue of the political reality of imprisonment. What do we as a society want from imprisonment? What does imprisonment symbolise? To what extent is imprisonment, you know, used in political discourse? To what extent do all of those things feed into the aims and objectives of the penal reform programme? Do they complement one another? Do they undermine one another? As well as institutional interests and the experience of those working in prison. It's well known, I'm sure by all of you and in academia, that actually what's written on policies and paper is not always how policies are implemented on the ground. So it is important that you actually talk to those who are on the ground at the coalface of implementing policies, as well as those who are experiencing the implementation of those policies, to get them to feed into reform processes. Because what managers might think might work may run into difficulties, practical difficulties on the ground that those practitioners can, and those, and like I said, at the receiving end of those policies, will immediately see. Other things that I would say is sometimes there's a tendency to view change management as a universal process rather than something that's specific and unique to a particular context or a particular institution. Now, there are universal features of change management projects, but there are also unique aspects of the particular institution or the particular jurisdiction that you're working with that is going to change how you do your business. So, for example, as I was saying, if you try and introduce practices that are in another jurisdiction but are designed for a larger prison estate to one that's a smaller prison estate, you're going to run into difficulties. So it's important when doing change management to actually think about the local context, the local issues, the local resources that you have. And that has been an issue, especially in doing penal reform programs in states that are in transition, either between different political systems and are coming out of conflict, where there can be a tendency to try and transplant practices from one jurisdiction to another. Now, yes, we should be looking at other jurisdictions and seeing what they're doing, but we just have to be mindful that actually they might need to be adapted to suit what we have and the resources at our disposal. A failure to do that can contribute to a lack of buy-in and cultural applicability as well. And like I said, I explore some of that a bit more in the briefing paper. So I'm going way over time. So what does some of this mean for at what I thought was going to be outcomes-based accountability? So based on this, I would say we need to consider including outcomes focused on communication, consultation, and engagement with those working and detained in prison. Okay? So it's very important that you talk to those who are actually involved in implementing the policies every day, as well as experiencing those policies to see what are the key factors getting in their way for performance, and then actually design your outcomes and your measures that should directly address those. Appreciate how fiscal challenges restrict reform efforts. This is going to be even more relevant now. There's no point in setting outcomes that are not achievable. It'll just demoralise staff and everybody involved. So you definitely want to be realistic about, with the budget you have, what is manageable for these organisations to do. Allow time for the paradox of reform effects to be overcome. Okay, you have to stick with reform programmes for a while. We know, like I said, that there is this paradox of reform. So if you're trying to get immediate results, that is not going to be what you see sometimes. These outcomes might demonstrate, like I said, at times an increase in tension or a decreased performance. But like I said, this is sometimes normal with reform programs until they're embedded. Ensure outcomes for different organisations are complementary, compatible with the overall reform programme, and promote interagency cooperation and efficiency. This is even more important now that we've got different providers involved in providing key services within our prisons and in the criminal justice system in general. So it's important that actually you look at what are the different outcomes for those different providers. Are they going to ensure that those different providers are working together and not in competition? And how do those outcomes align with the overall objectives of the reform programme, of your cost efficiency that you're looking for? Outcomes should be within the control of the organisation. Going to be a bit controversial here now and say, should prisons actually be judged on their ability to reduce reoffending rates? Now, maybe you'll want to... Yeah, I see some eyebrows raised. You might want to quiz me on that a bit more in questions and answers. What I would say to that, in a prison, people can work with the individual. You can do loads of work with the individual. You can do substance misuse issues, anger management issues, a whole range of different things. But what happens when that person gets released? Do they have somewhere to live? Do they have family or friends to support them? You could have given them employability skills, but is there an employer who's willing to take them on with a criminal record? None of those things are within the control of the prison service. You know, are they going to have access to mental health services that they might need when they get out? None of those things are within the control of the prison service. So is it fair to judge the prison service on those things that we know influence reoffending rates, that the prison service is not in control of? Is there things we can measure the prison service on that is linked to reoffending, that is within their control? Absolutely. We could actually look at things like, for example, the people who tend to end up being charged with misconduct offences. They're the ones that are a higher risk of reoffending. So why not have the prison do a programme with those individuals? There's a number of things that we could do, like I said, but we need to make sure that outcomes are within the control of the organisations that we look at. Like, so you might want to pick me up on that one in the questions and answers. Data should take account of the prison population and facilitate comparisons with other jurisdictions. So if you're going to use quantitative data, make sure that quantitative data has been adjusted for changes in the population. And that, like I said, will allow us to be able to judge our own performance across time as well as with different jurisdictions. We need, though, qualitative measures as well as quantitative measures. So we also need to know about people's experiences of these things, because those experiences are really important for the assistance and whether people will buy into them or not. We also know that with outcomes-based measures of accountability or performance, what gets done gets measured. So you need to think very carefully about what you're measuring and make sure that what you're measuring is what you want to see changed and not a proxy measure. So for example, if you're looking to see, if you're making a statement like, everyone is now going to be assessed for mental health or, you know, their educational needs like that within 7 days of entering prison. I'm making this up. Well, that's all well and good, but does that mean that they're actually then going to get access to services? There could be loads of assessments done. You could be meeting that assessment target, but you might have no more people actually finishing treatment programs. So you want to think very carefully about what you're measuring and make sure that it is what you want to get done.